Hello friends and welcome to PendulumIAS. Today we'll be discussing the current affairs quiz of 20 and 21st March 2020. Friends, if you have not subscribed our channel PendulumIAS, do subscribe it and do not forget to press the bell icon to receive notifications. So let's begin our quiz. So the first question is, which of the following correctly describes bilateral knitting agreement? And the options are, it is a bilateral agreement to set off the taxes between a company and its subsidiary. Second is, it is an agreement where goods can be exchanged for goods, or it is an agreement between the two parties to offset claims against each other and concluding a single net payment, and none of the above. So the correct answer for this is option C, that is, it is an agreement between two parties to offset claims against each other and concluding a single net payment. Let's see the detailed explanation of this question. Bilateral knitting agreement means the setting of claims between two parties, and it is used for concluding net payment. And the Union Cabinet is mulling to approve the bilateral knitting of qualified financial contracts bill 2020, but currently bilateral knitting is not allowed in India. So this is an important fact, and if this bill gets passed in the parliament and it receives the assent of president, then it will be allowed in India. Then bilateral knitting can reduce credit risk, free up capital for other productive uses, reduce hedging costs and liquidity needs for banks, primary dealers and other market makers. And thus it promotes participation in the OTC derivatives market to hedge against risk. So basically there are many advantages of bilateral knitting, and these advantages you should remember. There may be a question regarding which of the following are the advantages of bilateral knitting. And currently where it is allowed, it is allowed in US, UK, Australia, Canada, Japan, France, Germany, Singapore and Malaysia. These countries have provisions to allow bilateral netting. And keep in mind that the terms like this, bilateral netting or any other term which are in news, so these become important from exam point of view, especially UPSC civil services. Moving to the next question, which of the following is incorrect about the serious fraud investigation organization? And the statements are, first, a serious fraud investigation organization, SFIO, is an investigating and prosecuting agency under the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. Second, it is a non-statutory body set up by the resolution. Third, it looks into the cases within the legal framework of the Companies Act 1956. And fourth, the organization was set up on the recommendation of the Naresh Chandra Committee. So the statement which is incorrect is option B, that it is a non-statutory body set up by the resolution. Now let's see the detailed explanation. Serious Fraud Investigation Organization, SFIO, it is an investigating and prosecuting agency under the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, which look into various fraud cases under the Companies Act. And its legal framework or jurisdiction has been defined under the Companies Act of 1956. It was set up by a resolution adopted by the government in 2003, but it was given statutory status under Section 211 of Companies Act 2013. So now it is a statutory body. As per the Section 212(1) of the Companies Act 2013, the central government can give an investigation case into the affairs of the company to SFIO on the request from the central or the state government's departments, on a complaint by any other company in the public interest, or on receipt of a complaint from the registrar. Okay, so this was an important information regarding SFIO. Let's move to the next question. The next question is, which of the following is true about the Directorate General of Foreign Trade? You'll find that the questions related to economics, such type of questions are generally asked in UPSC Civil Services Prelims Examination. So we have tried to cover such type of questions in our daily quiz. So Keep following it. The question is, the statements are given as, it is an attached office of the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. It is responsible for implementing foreign trade policy. Third is, Kimberley Meet 2019 was chaired by the Directorate General of Foreign Trade. And you have to select the right answer from the quotes given below. 1 and 2 and 3 are correct. 1 only, 1 and 2 only, and 1 and 3. So the correct answer for this is option A, that is 1, 2 and 3. That is, all these statements are true. So let's see the detailed explanation. The Director General of Foreign Trade, it is an attached office of the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, and it is headed by DG of Foreign Trade. And right from its inception until 1991, when liberalization in the economic policies of the government took place, this organization has been essentially involved in the regulation and promotion of foreign trade through regulation. And keeping in line with the liberalization and globalization policies, the reforms, economic reforms that were introduced by the government in 1991. So keeping in line with the liberalization, globalization policies, or the overall objective of increasing exports, the DGFT has been assigned the role of a facilitator. This directorate, with its headquarters at New Delhi, it is responsible for formulating and implementing the foreign trade policy. So a statement can also be framed like this, that which body is responsible for formulating and implementing the foreign trade policy. And its aim is, main objective of DGFT is to promote India's exports. DGFT also issues scripts and authorization to exporters and monitors their corresponding obligations through a network of 38 regional offices and an extension counter at Indore. India headed the Kimberley Intergovernmental Meet of 2019, which was held in Mumbai, and it was chaired by the Director General of Foreign Trade. So statement 3 also becomes true. Talking about Kimberley Process Certification Scheme, it is an intergovernmental initiative which aims to curb the flow of conflict or rough diamonds, as these rough diamonds or conflict diamonds, they are used to finance conflicts or wars against government all over the world. Therefore, the certification scheme has been, this initiative has been taken, Kimberley Process, and it was established in 2003. Moving to the next question, which of the following is true about the pardoning powers of the president? The statements are, the governor of a state cannot pardon a death sentence. Second, if a death sentence has been given by the High Court, then it goes to Supreme Court as a matter of right. Third is both A and B, and fourth is none of the above. So the correct answer for this is option C, that is both A and B. Friends, under Article 161 of the Constitution, the pardoning powers of governor are defined, and a governor can grant pardons, reprieves, respites, remissions of punishment, but it cannot pardon the death sentence. This power is with president only, and the article related to pardoning powers of president is Article 72. Okay, pardoning powers of president. And one more additional thing, that governor can also not grant reprieve, pardon, commutation or remission to the punishment which have been given by court martial. So this is also a difference between the pardoning powers of governor and pardoning powers of president. So you need to go through this once, that what are the pardoning powers of governor and what are the pardoning powers of president. Okay, next is, if a death sentence has been given by a high court, or high court has taken a criminal case from the lower court and awarded a death sentence, then the appeal lies to the Supreme Court as a matter of right without any certification from the High Court under the appellate jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. Okay, so this statement is important because a separate question can also be framed regarding this point. Moving to the next question, the next question is, which of the following is true about Ignaz Philipp Semmelweis? He is known for proposing the practice of washing hands to reduce the cases of Puerperal fever, he is known for promoting homeopathy worldwide. Option C is both A and B, and option D is none of the above. So the correct answer for this is option A, that is, he is known for proposing the practice of washing hands to reduce the cases of puerperal fever. Let's see the explanation. Ignaz Philipp Semmelweis, he was a Hungarian physician and scientist, and he was known as early pioneer of antiseptic procedures. He is also known for discovering that washing hands with a chlorinated lime solution can reduce the incidence of puerperal fever. And what is this puerperal fever? It is a childbed fever or bacterial infection of mother's reproductive tracts. And this was very effective. That is washing hands with chlorinated lime solution, that it curbed the maternal mortality rate. And he was also known as the savior of the mother. And we all understand that due to the spread of this coronavirus, so the major preventive measures that wearing mask and washing hands regularly with soap and using sanitizer is the effective way. Okay, and this method of washing hands was discovered by Ignaz Philipp Semmelweis, and he suggested that washing hands for 40 seconds is very healthy. It's very important. Okay, moving to the next question, which of the following statement is true? First statement is former Chief Justice of India, Ranjan Gogoi, now can take part in the president's election. Second is the president nominates 12 members each in Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha based on their contribution in the field of art, science and social service. And third is no anti-defection case can be carried out against former CJI Ranjan Gogoi if he joins any party on April 20, 2020. Fourth statement is there is cooling off period of 2 years for the Supreme Court judges after they leave or resign or get retired from their services. So you have to tell that which statement is true. 1, 2, 3 and 4, 1, 2 and 4, 3 only, 2 and 3 only. So the correct answer for this is option C, that is 3 only. The third statement is correct. So let's see the detailed explanation. Recently, former CJI Ranjan Gogoi has been nominated as a member of Rajya Sabha by the Honorable President. And nominated members of both the Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha, they cannot take part in the election of the president. However, as they are nominated by the president, therefore they do not participate in the election of president, and they can participate in the impeachment of the president. So this statement is very important, that the nominated members can take part in impeachment process of president, but not in during the election of the president. So statement one is incorrect. Next, the president has the power to nominate 12 members belonging to the field of literature, science, art and social service in Rajya Sabha. Okay, these 12 members can be nominated in Rajya Sabha by the president belonging to various fields. Therefore, hence the statement two is incorrect. Third, a nominated member can be disqualified under anti-defection law if after 6 months of his nomination to the house, he or she joins any political party. So statement 3 is correct, because if our former CJI Ranjan Gogoi, if he joins any political party on 20 April, then that duration is before 6 months. And if before 6 months you join any political party, so you are not disqualified under anti-defection law. And which schedule is related to anti-defection law? It is 10th schedule of the Indian Constitution. Fourth is, there is no cooling off period prescribed for the Supreme Court or High Court judges in the Constitution after they leave off their judicial services, and therefore the statement 4 is incorrect. Therefore the answer was only 3 only, as only the third statement is true. Moving to the next question, Negev 7.62 into 51 mm light machine guns belong to which of the following countries? And the option are India, Israel, USA and Russia. So the correct answer for this is option B, that is Israel. So why was it in news? Let's see. So friends, recently the Indian Defense Ministry has signed a contract with Israel Weapons Industries to procure 16,479 Negev 7.62x51mm light machine guns. And these guns are more lethal and they have more range than the INSAS LMG that has a caliber of 5.56x45mm. And the procurement will be made through the fast track procedure, under which the army, they don't need to go through various formalities like raising requests for proposals, technical evaluation, trial evaluation for purchasing an established and tested product. And such type of procedures are followed to for any urgent contracts so that they do not face any unusual delays. Moving to the next question, the excise duty alcohol used for the manufacturing of sanitizer comes under which of the following list? And the options are union list, state list, concurrent list, and none of the above. So the correct answer for this is option A, that is union list. Friends, the excise duty on alcohol, which is not for human consumption, or alcohol, which is, I would say, ki alcohol which is not for human consumption but is used in medical products and toiletries, so it comes under entry 84 of the union list under the 7th schedule of the constitution. Talking about the 7th schedule, there are three lists in the 7th schedule. First is union list, second is state list, and third is concurrent list. Talking about union list, some of the subjects that are covered in union list are defense, then foreign affairs, railways, etc. And the subjects which are mentioned in union list, so a parliament has the exclusive right to legislate on these matters which are mentioned in union list. And the subjects which are mentioned state list, the state legislature has the exclusive right to frame any law on based on those subjects. And the subjects which are mentioned in concurrent list, state as well as parliament can frame law on such subjects, state as well as parliament. And in such cases, let's take an example, like some of the subjects like criminal law and all those matters which are included in CRPC, marriage and divorce, bankruptcy and insolvency, etc. So let's take an example that a state government has made some law on marriage and divorce, and on the similar subject parliament also made some law. So the particular law made by the parliament on the subject, on the same subject, will prevail, and that made by the state will stay void. But if any particular act on a subject, let's take an example, if a law has been made on any matter related to CRPC by the state and by a particular state, and parliament has approved that, so that particular act will prevail in that particular state. Okay, but that requires the approval of parliament. Otherwise, if parliament has also made the law on the same subject, that will prevail if parliament does not approve it. Talking about state list, some of the subjects are police, public order, health, agriculture, etc. So go through the list, the three lists which are mentioned in 7th schedule and the subjects related to it, so that if any question arises, because it helps in your writing mains answers also and also in the prelims question. So go through the list once, it will be very helpful to you. So friends, here we end our session. So please like this video, share with your friends, and comment your views in the comment box. Do not forget to subscribe our channel and also press the bell icon to receive notifications. and keep preparing well. All the best.